said that is because we're proud to have the youth of the United States working with the GAS program. And that is one of the purposes of the GAS program, is to foster enthusiasm in the younger generation in the use of space.
The GAS team over the last 2.5 years has been working very hard. They've been very busy. They've been updating the hardware and the software to the post-Challenger requirements. And I'm happy to report that mission has been accomplished. The hardware and software is ready. The GAS team is ready. And the flight opportunity picture is looking very good.
This is certainly an exciting and important moment for us, this return to flight. And the GAS CAM program itself is an exciting program to us. There have been, more GAS CAM payloads on shuttle than any other type of payload we've flown. We've flown 76, I think it is, GAS type payloads. We've flown 53 actual what you call getaway special programs. And we're looking forward to the four on STS-29. It's a unique opportunity that we have nowhere else. And we in NASA think that's a very important part of the program. It's a very important part. Space is excitement. It's the challenge of going out there and looking for the future. That's why it's so important to have the young people involved, because they are the future. And it's important for them to be able to participate in something like that and be a part of it.
Good morning. I'd like to start by welcoming all of our foreign delegates and tell you that we appreciate your trip out here. Foreign payloads make the GAS program fun and interesting.
And the students, the winner who submitted the proposals, we have the opportunity to watch the launch of Space Shuttle, on which their experiment will be placed. So many students, they're very anxious to get a chance to go to the United States. The criterion for the selection are the creativity, scientific merits, and the experiment feasibility and organization. Since it's our first such program, and we should say the Chinese students, they learn different lessons, natural science, but they don't know very much about space science. And so generally, but many teachers guide them to submit such proposals.
The first subject is the electrolytic separation of biological substances. Electrolysis is a key technology in refinement and pharmacy in space. The second is the separation of gas bubbles from liquid. Cultivation and fermentation involve carbon dioxide, and which interferes other normal reactions. Then, the technology for this separation will be needed in cultivation and fermentation in space. The third is the cultivation of cellular slime molds. This experiment provides the fundamental knowledge on the effect of gravity on living organisms. The last is the protein crystal growth. To obtain large, well-ordered protein crystal is fundamentally important in protein engineering. The microgravity environment is expected to be suitable for growing such protein crystals.
We have about 36 kilograms for payload. It means about 50% of this experimental platform can be used for different experiments. And if we are able exactly to have the exactly orientation, so we can take different experiments which really need the pointing system. And that's what's really new in this system. I think Free Flyers and NewSat and other small satellites have shown that it's possible. We would like to go one step forward and mainly with the idea using a commercial components for making it cheaper first, and second, using a rather cheap launcher. It's, I think, the only one now is a gas possibility.
As the MALS standard system has been presented in former gas symposia in detail, we'll just concentrate on three major topics. May I have the next view graph? The first one will be the next future MALS payloads. The second one, improvements to the MALS standard system. And last but not least, the twin MALS concept. Next one, please. Right now, we have four MALS payloads in the row, which we are looking forward to fly them pretty soon. Two of them are reef flights with modified scientific objectives, and the other two are new experiments. This is the first one and the third one. They are new experiments. Two of them are dealing with Marangoni convection, and the other one is heat transfer phenomena, and one dealing with glass finding.
We'd like to describe the three experimental systems, mainly on material sciences, on microgravity for Gateway Special Program. This experimental systems are aimed to the demonstration to stimulate space utilization in Japan and basic research for material processing in space. And in Japan, we had already two experimental systems for Gateway Special Program from. And the first one is snow experiment. And it was from in 1984. And the second is the collision experiment between water ball and metal ball. It was from in 1985. And two experimental systems were manufactured by and developed by NEC Corporation and Asahi Shimbun newspaper.
Proposed to try to tell you something today, first about the process of manifesting, and then to talk a little bit about the some things that are on the manifest, and then a word or two toward the end about prospects for manifesting gas payloads. The manifest serves many purposes. It is, among other things, the starting point for the planning of the operations. I think that's probably the way most people think about it when they first encounter it. But it is also a very important instrument for the definition of priorities. There's a lot of contention, particularly as we see it currently, where the demand for flight opportunities exceeds the our capacity to meet the demand. And so the manifest is the place where those priorities get resolved. It's I would say, just about up on a par with the budgeting process in terms of high-level resolution of priority questions. One thing that isn't on this chart at all is the requirements of the payloads. When they want to fly, what they want to do, how big they are. And that, of course, is a very important element.
I have to apologize. I was scolded when I left. This is session two, DoD-related payloads.
So, applications. We at Defense Systems don't take the name literally by just defense. In other words, we are looking at scientific payloads, much like have been presented today. We're looking at platforms that can be used to qualify new capabilities, recorders, imaging devices, things that I can't talk about in this arena, but things that are very, very exciting for the future, and the use of small platforms for those applications. Communications is the foremost one. It's the easiest. It's the one that fits within the gas envelope of criteria, as you'll see in a minute. But let me just stretch your imagination, and if you've got an idea, we should pursue it and talk about it in this forum, because the chances are excellent that it could fly.
Basically, we deal with research and development type payloads, and we use whatever means are available to get these guys into space. We use large missions on expendable payloads. We piggyback on larger satellites. For example, I'm working several experiments which we're flying on the NOAA TYRO satellites. We use shuttle sortie, for instance, GAS and Hitchhiker, and we also launch free flyers from the shuttle. Since our establishment, we have racked up quite a few successes. As you can see here, we've launched 42 expendable payloads and 16 shuttle.
Now, I don't know if many of you heard that there are limitations to the GAS program, but there are limitations today. The Johnson Space Center, Kennedy Space Center headquarters, and Goddard got together and said, put a hold on doing all these real neat things that you've been doing in the past because of the Challenger. Okay, and we want to limit what the GAS program can do. But there are other customers out there in the science community that need assistance in using GAS-type hardware. But we can't put them in the GAS program because the astronauts, for instance, would like to see a GAS payload and it is benign. They know if they can turn it on and it works, that's wonderful. If they turn it on, it doesn't work, it's not going to create any sort of catastrophe or be any sort of a problem to the shuttle. So what has happened, we've come up with a name, Complex Self-Contained Payloads, CSCP. What that means is payloads that are outside the limitations of the GAS program.
I'll be discussing the safety approval process for small self-contained payloads, and specifically GAS payloads. As George pointed out a few minutes ago, it's a little bit different for GAS payloads. Goddard is given the responsibility to what I'll call qualify a payload through phase two, and then we do a face-to-face review with JSC and KSC for the phase three approval. The Getaway Special safety approval process is a four-phase process, as most of you know, and this comes in the form of four data submittals. The phase zero typically corresponds with our payload accommodations requirements document, which is submitted ideally 12 to 14 months prior to a launch.
The payload accommodation requirement, or the PAR, is it's a key document because it's really the only document where the flight operation information is between Goddard Space Flight Center and the customer. So I got to stress that this document we must really look at in regards to the flight operation requirements and make sure that we have them exactly as we want them. Also, Susan and myself input documents to JSC that are used for the mission, the crew activity plan and the crew and the operation checklist. We also support the GAS customers during the mission, and we provide you post-flight data after the completion of the mission. The PAR information. Once again, let's try and make sure that the PAR information is clearly stated. What information do you really need? Well, first there's the operational scenario, and that basically says what will happen during the mission from start to finish. We also have flight design, which talks about the altitude, the inclination, the orientation, and the stabilization of your payload. Flight activity, we have tables. One is the payload control functions and the payload operations plan. And we specify post-flight mission data requirements that the customer needs, and also any optional service that are not standard in the other flight operation sections. Another key point is a conceptual layout of the payload, and we need that as we input that document to JSC.
The main objective of the payload is measuring heavy ions in the near-Earth environment and using the magnetic field of the Earth to determine the ionic charge of these ions. Now, this can be done on this payload in the energy range of 0.5 to 100 MeV per nucleon. And The first objective is measuring the charge of the so-called anomalous component. What this component is, we will see in a minute, and why it's so interesting for us. Now, the second objective was determination of ionic charge of solar cosmic rays, which is the only way to do it with this type of experiment using the Earth's magnetic field, because at these energies of, say, tens of MeV per nucleon, a direct measurement of the ionic charge is impossible. Now, the ionic charge is interesting so far because particles generated at the sun and propagating through the interplanetary space from the sun to the Earth don't change their charge states anymore. Therefore, the measurement in the near-Earth environment gives a direct correlation to the environment at the sun, as, for instance, densities or temperatures at the site where these particles are accelerated in the solar corona. Now, the third objective is more obvious. That's measurement of the energetic heavy ion environment, which is interesting for practical purposes like single event upsets.
Hello, my name is Susan Olden. For our first presenter, the subject is systems report for payload G652, and the presenter is Mike Muckerheide.
Just briefly, I'll explain 652 in a few select areas. One, we're trying to combine amino acids in space, or generate them, by introducing certain chemicals. And we're replicating some of the work of Miller from the 1950s, in which an electrical spark was discharged in a Mars jar. And in this Mars jar, he tried to attain amino acid capability. Amino acids are the building blocks of life. So by introducing that spark, he did combinate. And we have felt for some time that the space environment is the place to do it. And the reason for that is that, one, on the Earth, you have gravity, and you have magnetic fields also, which you also have in space. However, the microgravity environment, when the spark is discharged, tends to pull upon the plasma, as does it pull upon the electrical system, as does every other piece of that unit. So you have attraction to the walls of the particular chamber. But most importantly, you have, by using electrodes, you have contamination introduced into the experiment, because the electrodes sputter off the metallic vapor into the environment. So we've designed a system to take a laser and pulse it at high rep rates in a central location within a vial, so that we can combinate the chemicals without electrode involvement and without sputter being able to contaminate that environment. Besides, we'll be doing it in microgravity, and so we feel the experiment is more realistic.
Now, they're going to be broken up into there's four quadrants, and there'll be larvae. Now, there's also glowworms. You know, the larvae of a firefly also glows, and it has a luminescence about it. Bioluminescence is really found in a lot of places, especially under the seas. There's a sensitivity on the film at this point, but I have been able to capture it. It'll look like a little dot.
And that the students and the educational aspect of the GAS program is very important. You know, we in the GAS team support the educational institutions from the high school level through colleges and so forth. But one thing we have to remember is that it's the engineering experience that's very important to the student, because they're the ones that will be taking over for people like myself and the rest of the GAS team in years to come.
The primary purpose of the experiment that we're flying on G254 is to produce a small thin wall bubble. The bubble will be about 1 inch in diameter. We're going to be using diffusion pump oil and a surfactant to produce a non-UV curing bubble. And you might ask, why on earth would somebody want to form a bubble in microgravity? And that's a fair question to ask. And I guess what I would say is that the reason we're doing it is that we have a corporate sponsor who's quite interested in the end product of a UV-curable thin film structure in space. And we thought that a bubble was kind of a neat way to look into that problem. The end product of the UV-curable bubble, I'm not that sure of, although I do know it has some DOD
related things, and as a result, I really haven't been briefed to any extent on what it might be used for, although you can probably guess some of the possible uses for it. What we expect to observe with the production of the small bubble is the dynamics resulting from plateau region drainage, as well as the dynamics resulting from differences induced in surface tension on the bubble surface.
The water droplet, which is a charged droplet in this case, undergoes some expansion due to the electric field and the forces occurring on it. Initially, the water droplet is a sphere, a perfect sphere. And when you set it across the electric field, it expands due to the forces. The forces are the normal force due to the electric field, and you also have the surface tension of the water droplet, and the pressure inside and outside of the droplet remains constant as it's expanding, but the pressure is not constant along the surface of the water droplet. So that means that there is some induced flow inside and outside of the water droplet to account for all the forces and balance out all the forces. So in this water droplet, you will see some flow, and you see the water droplet expand.
We'll provide post-flight life support only because we're kind of limited in the gas can and as far as mass and power and volume. And I've heard 2 kilowatts of power. That's way too much for my experiment. So I can only provide post-flight life support, and since I'll be using a dry sample for 6 months, then that's kind of easy to do. In order to provide a CO2 oxygen atmosphere, I will have to have an airtight chamber, because although the gas can temperature the pressure is only 1 atmosphere nitrogen, and I only need 1 atmosphere for my sample, there's various tests, the compression test on the gas can that might cause some of the nitrogen to flow in, and that would be deleterious to my experiment. Although if that did happen, I could still get data because photosynthesis still occurs in nitrogen, but it would change the results I would get.
You see the 3 major systems. The first one is the boiling experiment. This experiment involves nucleic boiling of a freon 111. The next experiment is a polymer experiment dealing with material processing of nylon to determine if enhanced properties will be generated while in space, such as longer molecule chains, and of course, my interest, the computer subsystem. On the next slide, you see that the purpose of the computer subsystem is one purpose and one purpose only, that is to support the experiments. The support will be in 2 areas. The first is the control system support, the sequencing of the events that will occur during the experiment. This will include like turning on heaters, running motors, things of that nature. The second item is the data acquisition, which will be real-time data acquisition of temperature and pressure readings.
Space debris is a growing concern, and some conferences lately, and again magazines, they are saying that we really are going to have to deal with it, even though numbers dictate that the probability is so low that anything could happen to the space station. That probability is still there, and we can't just assume, well, we're going to go in there with low probability, and if we do get hit and some life is lost, that happens only very seldomly, so it's acceptable. Well, it's not acceptable. That's not the way to do things. We have to supply ourselves with tools that will allow NASA or the astronauts that are up there to correct any odd scenarios that may come up.
So as the impurities build up, you get an increasingly unstable region there. And at some point, some of them are going to be displaced upwards a little bit, and they'll start to warm because they move into a warmer part of the melt, and then they just keep rising. They'll take off from there and diffuse into the entire crystal. And that's what we call fingering effect, where you'll get little fingers of solute rising up there. And this is sort of good because it helps relieve your boundary layer. It gets rid of that boundary. And what I want to do is eliminate those thermal and buoyancy-driven convections, and then we can study that boundary layer, how it evolves and how it affects the crystal growth. That's the purpose of this experiment.
Basically, we have three research experiments. One is a foam metal material processing experiment, another moisture desorption of carbon epoxy samples, and the third is a nuclear particle detector. First, I'd like to talk about the foam metal material processing. What we're trying to achieve with this is produce a foamed metal in space due to the fact that it's difficult to produce them on Earth to get an even distribution of gas or gas bubbles inside your foam metal.
Talk a little bit about manifesting. There is a new manifesting policy for small payloads as of 787. Secondary payloads are considered anything under 8,000 pounds, except getaway special. These payloads go in after primary payloads, and then getaway special goes in after the secondary payloads. Part of the secondary payload policy is there is emphasis on domestic microgravity research and space station support.
That. With that, I'd like to introduce Major James Foss. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. It's a real pleasure for me to be here tonight to speak to you. This is really quite a group. You're doing something that I would have liked to have done at any time during my life. That's putting something on a vehicle that's going to go out in space, and you're going to gather some information that hopefully is going to do us all some good in the future. That was kind of boring to me. Were you all bored by all that stuff? Sorry. Where's Tom? Can you turn on my slide projector for me, please? Thank you. Today I went over to the Kennedy Space Center and I drove out to the launch pad 39B and I took a look at the Space Shuttle Discovery sitting out there on the pad. And it brought back memories of over 2.5 years ago when I stood out there and looked at the Space Shuttle Challenger before its launch. And as I looked out there today, I thought about the 2.5 years plus of work that's been done, the thousands and thousands of hours, and the thousands of people that have been involved in getting us back to the point where we are now, ready to return the Space Shuttle safely to flight. We've reevaluated the entire Space Shuttle program, from the management to the hardware, all aspects of the program, and we've made a lot of modifications based on all the work that we've done. And tonight I'd like to spend just a little bit of time talking to you about some of the things that we've done to bring us back to flight again, and then just a little bit about the STS-26 flight itself. And then I have a little movie that I'll show you. It's a little bit old, but it shows the deployment of a TDRS satellite on STS-6, and that's what's going to be done on STS-26, and I thought you might appreciate seeing that, so when they talk about it, you'll know a little bit more about what's going on.